It's a good movie, right?
I love that movie. And it was like, they had a hard time selling it, but they did.
They did. I wish it had made more. But like, I mean, he's my dad or whatever, but if I had my way, that would have been nominated for everything.
Yeah.
I just thought there wasn't a performance that year that I thought was more accomplished and did more and moved me more than what he did. I did this before with Matthew McFadden.
Yes. And still, we still get comments on it on a regular basis.
Oh, really?
Well, you each have your fans.
Matthew being sexy? Yeah.
He's so hot. Oh, Matthew.
Yeah.
But you get those too. You get some.
Voice. Oh, well, yeah? Yeah. Oh, I'll have to check it out. I am interested in this kind of stuff. Yeah, for sure. But it's more Alex's writing, right? I mean, I think he's kind of the best at what he does at the moment, you know. I've been a fan of his for a long time, so the script was just amazing. He sent me the script kind of out of the blue, and it was just immediately the only thing I wanted to do that year, you know.
Mm. Yeah. And was it already cast up, or was it you first, or?
Yeah, I think it was me first. It was. I talked to him, and then, you know, it's all well and good that he wanted me to do it, but it's, you know, it's a... For what I guess is an indie movie, it's a lot of money, you know, so you have people to convince. So I had producers and financiers and stuff to convince. So I went around to his house and we did a kind of an audition, not for him, but for them. And that went well. And so I was, you know, pretty quickly the deal got done. It was good. And then I kind of got to see him go through the, you know, the ideas for people he would cast in the other... In the other roles. It was very interesting.
So did you read with other actors at this thing?
No, he didn't. I don't even know if he auditioned. Oh yeah, at least he did an audition tape. But no, I don't think he believes in all those. I've the notion of like a chemistry read, I think, is just the... I think cast two good actors and they'll have chemistry. I just don't think... I don't buy into the other stuff.
So it took a while to come together?
I'm burping. That bloody sparkling water is insanely sparkling. It took a little bit of time, I think, to get everybody, but it was pretty clear. Once Alex had decided on who he wanted, it was like just a matter. He gets what he wants, and then also they were so eager to do the film. It was so clear. There are some scripts that just once people read it, everybody wants to do. You just hear around. That everybody wants to do it. And I think this was one of the scripts, so I think we all consider ourselves fortunate. I don't think anybody was ever going to not do it once it was an offer or once it was on the table, you know.
So what about the character? I mean, it's interesting to you. It seems like you were off and coming of age in these movies.
Yeah, I guess... Yeah, it's a funny one because he has to carry the weight of all that the audience is learning. He carries himself throughout the movie, so... It's subtly complicated, I think, what's happening with Caleb. I don't think he's just a kind of a wide-eyed, naive sort of person. And actually, there's a shift that happens. And it's a spoiler, but there's a shift that happens about two-thirds of the way through the movie that we don't see, but that happens, which is that Caleb takes control, which you only find out right at the very end of the movie. But so actually for a good half hour before that, he did get Nathan drunk. You know what I mean? Like he did switch around the key card. So that knowledge is fine for him, but the audience doesn't know it. There was a kind of bunch of different little mirrors and things and hidden things that are going on there that he has to kind of, that have to work in both versions of the movie for an audience who don't know that yet. And then if anyone ever goes back to watch it again, it still has to make sense. It can't all just, you know, like, oh, you know, that doesn't work. So it was, I found it actually very complicated kind of making him. He has to be an endless group of possibilities. Mm. At a certain stage, you have to think that he may be an AI. At a certain stage, you have to think that he's totally dumb. At another stage, you have to think that he is Nathan's superior, perhaps, you know, like all those things. He has to fit into all those things. So actually finding a person who fit all of them was tough enough.
Do you do it almost like a is it like a song, is it like a you know, a symphony where you're trying to figure out where you are in each piece of it, because obviously you're shooting out of order too?
Yeah, right. But we had a little bit of rehearsal with Alex, and it's also, the script is so finely written that I think what it does is when you read it, it said there are certain things that the character has to be for the story to work. So you start with the things that he has to be. Mm-hmm. And then you can make other choices around it about how strong or weak he is, you know what I mean? And where you can push out the limits a little bit. But actually, it was pretty clear everything that Caleb had to be all the way through once you really pay attention to the story. And then because we'd rehearsed it and we had a table read, just the four of us. Mm-hmm. Like normally table reads, you have everybody in. The production designer, Alex, didn't want to do it at all. And I asked him if we could read it amongst ourselves just to get a sense of the shape of it. And the speed of it, for example, is really important, right? Mm-hmm. How quickly those scenes pass by and if anything was extraneous or not. And that was really helpful because just in your head then you can go back and think, right, what do I think? What does he think? What does the audience have to think? Do we have to take that into account or not? You know, it's really strange. But it's the fact that he's a straightforward, good guy, I think, yeah. I think just makes it seem like you just turn up and say the lines. And I guess to an extent that's what you do too. It'd be lying to make it more complicated than that.
Maybe. So is there a lot of, I mean, are there other performances in there that he shot that are on the floor, or are you pretty dead on?
No, yeah, there are other versions of it in there. I think there are stronger versions of it and weaker versions of it, but it's always the same guy. And the same would be said for Oscar, I would imagine, but with Alicia, there's a whole bunch of performances because she gave it every which way. She gave it more robotic, more more female, more sensual, more naive, more, you know. She had a lot of different things that she tried out, sometimes all in the same scene, which are they're the great takes, you know. Mm. And so I think there's probably a lot of different ways it could go in the edit with each of us.
Hmm.
But you just have to trust Alex with what he has.
Because Oscar seems most completely straightforward of the characters.
Oh, he's very complicated. Yeah, right, right. But there's a million different ways that a bull can act in a china shop, you know what I mean? Like, it depends what he takes down first. So, there was lots of different things. Ones where he was more complimentary and open, and then other bits where he's... I mean, it's just the usual thing with acting, I guess. But Alex didn't want us to do too many takes. We only had shot the whole movie in 6 weeks, you know? So it was like, get it done quick, you know?
Have you been in anything that was this kind of intimate? I mean, it's really a three-hander.
I've done plays. And,
it's funny because it doesn't feel like a play. It doesn't feel
which is really important. No, I know. I agree. Yeah,
it's so isolating. The three of them are so isolated.
Yeah, and it's a chamber piece, I think. Yeah. Oscar described it as a chamber piece, which is true. So, yeah, it could be. You could, like, describe it in those terms. But it never felt like a play to me. It always felt like a real movie.
Mm.
Which is really important, because why go to the theater to, or why go to a movie theater to watch a play? You know, you can just go to a theater to watch that. But Alex, I think, is just so, he's so visual, and he's also just so filmic as well. I think he was never going to fall into that. But yeah, in terms of intimacy, I've done intimate scenes in things which felt as intimate as this movie.
Mm-hmm.
But in terms of a whole experience, perhaps not. I think that's about as... But it didn't feel intimate. It felt pressurized, you know?
Hmm. Because of the pressure of the work, or because you had to get
both.
It and move on?
I guess I was... I guess I kind of am in every scene in the movie. Caleb takes on a lot of weight over the course of the film, as I said. Like, you know, like, he's under a lot of pressure from Nathan. He's under a lot of pressure from Ava. So he's getting it from all angles, and I just think that adds up. And then we were in like a heat wave in London in a tin box of a studio with lights and glass and all that sort of stuff. So we were just melting as well. So it felt like quite a pressurized environment. Great, but kind of it was intense. It was an intense 6 weeks.
And what was that set like? I mean, it's a gorgeous set.
Yeah, it was mad, because it's a mixture of the two, right? We did 4 weeks in Pinewood.
Mm-hmm.
For all the underground bunkery type of stuff, you know, those corridors and the rooms with Ava, the interview rooms, and some of the rooms with Nathan. And then we went for 2 weeks to Norway and shot part of that house in like a hotel, which is gorgeous, Juvet it's called, and then part of it in a privately owned house, which they kind of they somehow matched them together, you know, to make them look like the same place. So it was a relief when we got to go to Norway, because it was just so intense in the other place and so warm. Suddenly a little bit of open space felt very welcome.
Hmm. That's a... By the time you were done being out of that, were you wanting to kind of go back and redo what you had done in the closed space? I mean, did that affect you?
Interesting. Yeah. Maybe. I do. Yeah, we got to a place which was, which felt fairly full on. But I think it was necessary for the movie. I think when you watch the movie, you can feel tension. Mm-hmm. When I watch it, I can feel it. Maybe that's just me reliving it, so I'm not sure. But when I watch it, I can feel the walls closing in mm-hmm. as it goes on. And that's what it felt like when we shot it. So I think it's good that it's in there.
Yeah.
But also we laughed a lot. Like, Oscar's very funny. Alex is like really, really funny. And Alicia too. So it was like there was and the cast. No, Alicia was, but they were.
She's a laugh,
they used to, but she was suffering, man. She was in that like costume and everything. She was. If I like every time I thought like I'm pretty warm, I'm getting pretty, you know, dabbing, and you look over and I think I can't even open my mouth. She's wearing a rubber suit. It's not that's not okay for me to feel bad for myself. It was a funny experience, and the crew were all great as well. So it was like. There was lots of relief of the tension, but the tension was primary.
Was it nice to have a reunion with Alicia?
Fantastic, yeah. She's brilliant. I mean, as you know, she's brilliant. She's brilliant. So it was great. Like, once she was cast, it was, you know, you're never worried that it's not going to work or that you're not going to have a connection. She's so great. The connection was there already, and we had all these shortcuts from when we did Anna Karenina with Joe and with Sidi Larbi Cherkawi. So we, you know, felt like we'd be able to access, because they have to create love in there, the possibility of love in that little glass box. It's a really strange thing to have to do, to have to build something real in there under those situations with all the cameras and being looked at. You have to create moments of tenderness maybe through silence and glances and things like that. And once she was cast, it was like, oh, we're going to be okay, I think. We'll have to work hard, but it's going to be okay, you know.
Well, she's certainly one of the great silent actresses of the last 20 years. I mean, it's just the amount she can get out of her head, out of her eyes, without saying a word is kind of breathtaking.
Pretty spectacular, yeah. At one point, we were going to do these things, these silent takes. I think maybe she had done it on a job previous. We're going to do every scene without the words. Mm-hmm. That was an idea, but then that got dropped really quickly just because of time restraints. But that would have been fun. But I mean, actually, you just don't need it with Alicia, like you say. It's all so present anyway. You know, you get in close enough to see it, and it's very, very present. You know,
well, she seems to get talkier as the character goes along in the script. She's kind of quiet.
They loosen up, right? Yeah. I mean, because they start becoming comfortable in each other's presence, and that was really interesting with the body language too, figuring out where we stood. Mm. How we reacted to each other. So by the end, they're sitting right up against the glass, talking to each other, you know, very close, wanting to touch, really, and not being allowed, which of course is one of the great things that you can build, is if you don't allow people to touch each other, they're going to want to do that. And you can really build that tension into the, you know, into the space. So you can really feel a desire to connect in a different way. Yeah, she does. She gets chattier as she goes on, but she also learns more about him and more about how to interact with people, right? Yeah.
So you can see her growth. What she's going to do.
Exactly.
You know, what she wants to do, what she needs to do.
Yeah. I still hold on to, I don't know how much spoilers matter and stuff like that.
No, you're good.
But
make sure everybody who sees this has seen the movie.
My opinion, yeah, right. My opinion is that they fall in love. That's my opinion, is that it's not one big hoax and one big scam to manipulate him and get him out and to get out. And my opinion is that there is something real there, and that when she comes in at the end of the movie, this is definitely a spoiler, when she comes in at the end of the movie and sees him weakened in a way that only flesh and blood can be weakened, he's bleeding, I think she thinks, I can't take him with me, we're not going to survive, the two of us on the outside.
Yeah.
And she goes by herself and leaves him in there. I think that's how I choose to see the movie, but I know a lot of people see it differently.
Well, it's one of the things that's great about the movie is I think that those, even after the movie plays out, I think you can come at it from three or four different directions and see the truth in each of them.
Yeah, because Alex's version is he's totally pro AI. He thinks it is the right thing to do. He considers it a happy ending, and I don't consider it quite that.
Yeah, there are a bunch of movies that I can think are happy endings, and people are like, "What?
Like what?
God, I have to think of one now." But it's like you know, something dark and horrible happens. Well, like the ending of Fight Club is the classic one, where people thought it was a terrible ending, the world's blowing up. But the whole point of that ending is that they're
together.
For
them, it's happy. Yeah, yeah.
Right. Is that the world will go on no matter what happens.
Yeah.
They have each other now, so they can go on.
Yeah.
Even if all of Los Angeles is being blown up.
Yeah, which is not good. Let's face it.
Well,
that's not a
living in Los
thing.
Angeles long enough, you know, maybe that's a good
really?
Thing.
I'm happy to be here, man. Some sunshine is nice.
So, if things changed, does anything about all this change for you after, you know, it's been a couple years since Anna Karenina?
Mm-hmm.
A lot's been going on. You've had some leads. You've had some supporting. You've been in bigger movies. Does it feel different? Does it feel like...
It feels less... A little less likely that I'll be like unemployed for a year, which I've done before. So it feels a little less likely that you know, that will happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you always want to, like, I didn't think I would get to play the lead and stuff, really, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then the fact that I've got to do it a few times has been amazing. Like, really amazing. That's not a career. Mm. It's a career I wanted, but didn't think I would get to.
Mm-hmm.
But then obviously you just want to continue. No one's ever happy with where they are. It's pathetic, but it's true. And so, yeah, I mean, part of me still wants to get, you know, wants to be in every day on another movie with Alex or another, you know what I mean? So you keep on wanting more for yourself and you keep on being either disappointed or whatever by what you've done before. And I guess you just try and use that to drive you forward. So it does feel slightly different, but I'm still learning a lot. Mm-hmm. I still have a lot to learn also.
So how does that manifest? How do you learn? Are you learning just by doing, or?
Yeah, I think it's the only way to do. I mean, also you can ask advice from people and stuff, but even the advice that people give you, really you have to learn for yourself. I've gotten some great advice from my dad over the years and just about how to get through a scene or how to, you know, and the likelihood is even if he gives me the advice, I'll make the same mistakes that everybody else makes in those scenarios, you know? I'll never, like, my very first time on a movie set, I could, you know, that you got to hit a mark. They put a little piece of tape on the floor and you're supposed to walk up and talk to somebody. There's a camera here and you're not supposed to look at your feet. And it's important for focus that you, God, man, like it was like 10, 12, you know, and I've been told, you know what you do? You can do a couple different things. You can take six steps back from it for your six steps up. You know what I mean? And then you're hit it every time, or you can just look at it and then look at the person and just feel it as a, like, you know, I got told all that stuff and I missed my mark every single time that I walked up. I probably still miss it every single time, but I'm getting slightly better at it. But all those mistakes and stuff, you have to make for yourself. So I'm still making those mistakes and I still watch stuff and think, why didn't I do that differently, or why didn't I follow the advice that I was given? And I thought I was following it at the time, but it's just difficult to have perspective on it, I guess.
Does something like that integrate into your work? I mean, do you forget about it after you learn how to hit the mark, or?
Yeah, I think you do. But it's a little bit, you know, you always have to get back up to speed in a movie set. If you're off a film for like 3 months, I find a lot of the stuff you just have to remember again. You got to be in the situation, and but rather than take 12 takes to get back on the horse or the bike or whatever the hell shitty analogy I'm using, it just takes one or two and then you're back up to speed. Yeah.
And have you
on the horse?
Or on the horse.
Yeah, yeah.
What other metaphor?
Yeah, it's a nightmare.
Or on the skateboard. Can you? I mean, do you have a sense of career at this point, or are you still just looking for that job?
I was reading like an interview with Ryan Reynolds in the car on the way here. Mm. And he was saying at the end of his career, he would like to look back and see a bunch of genres done well. That's what he would like to see. I think that's a really good idea for a career. I think that's a really good thing to aim for. And I would love for that to be the case. And so you just try for that, I guess. So I don't have a sense of career, but I know that I don't want to do the same thing over and over. I know that it's necessary to change, to challenge yourself.
Does big matter to you? I mean, are you inking to be a Marvel superhero? Or?
Oh, no. No, I don't need any of that sort of stuff, no. But I would like to continue to be able to do movies like Ex Machina. And one way to do that is by being somebody who people know who you are, so that you don't have to audition for everybody and maybe not make it through one of the hoops on the way to getting the part, you know? So. But no, I like my life the way it is. I don't fancy being stopped on the street, you know.
So does a movie like the Richard Curtis movie, I mean, huge success in Europe, much less of a success in the United States, barely released in the United States, really. Not very well handled here, unfortunately. But I mean, is that something you focus on or think about or worry about? Or you
no. Just well, I mean, the weird thing is, like, it is really in America, that's the thing that people stop me for, is about time. A bunch of people seem to have seen it since it did. Yeah, it didn't do well in the cinema. Weird number of people seem to have seen it and called their fathers afterwards, which is very nice. But no, the reason I liked that was because it made me laugh, and I thought it was a genuinely kind-hearted movie that had something positive to say about the world. I love that. I mean, I'm all for that because I like my melancholy more than most people. But that was a really, so I like that a lot. And that the thing that attracted me to that film wasn't the fact that it was a bigger movie. It was the fact that, oh my God, it was a lead. That was my first, I had done a lead in a thing called Sensation, but that was like 3 years prior. And it was about an Irish farmer who becomes a pimp. And it was like a Todd Solondz type of really, really, really dark, possibly comedy. So it was very intense, right? So this was like, oh my God, like being a lead in a movie like this would be amazing. I can't believe they're even considering me for it. So that was, I mean, I was just delighted about that, you know? It wasn't the fact that it was a big thing. It was the fact that it was breezy and funny and, you know.
But once it happens, do you feel that pressure that, you know, oh, it's got to be this, or oh, it's going to affect me this way, or oh, it's going to...
No, I wish more people had seen it. Right. I wish more people had seen it. Like, it made more in South Korea than it did in America.
Well, South Korea loves Rachel McAdams.
Or, you know, this guy. Rachel McAdams.
Van Damme is still huge in the Philippines, so...
Is he?
Yeah.
Well, he's big in beer ads now, too, right? He's got it all going on. But, it was... I wish that more people had seen it first time round.
Yeah.
But actually, it seems to have caught up since, like I say. So I'm really happy with that movie. You know, I'm really happy. That's one of the ones where I say, no, I think I did as good a job as I could have done. I don't know what else I could have done.
And do you just take away the pleasure from having done that work? Is that the main thing to you at that point? How do you put it behind you, or this movie too?
I mean, oh yeah, well, you put it behind you because you have to, because you got to play a new guy in the next thing. So really the best way to leave something behind is by finding something new. You do tend to stew in the... This is disgusting, but you tend to stew in the juices of what you did before for quite a while afterwards, I find. It does tend to hang around until you're just on to the next thing. Because then a clean break is necessary. It's required for you to do your job. And so you're forced into a new way of thinking. You're forced into working with a whole new group of people who you don't know.
So like relationships.
Exactly like a relationship. It is that. Except for stewing in your own juices after a relationship ends is a really bad way to spend your time.
It is indeed.
Yeah, you can
and
hurt
yet
yourself.
People can't stop themselves.
No, I know. It's human nature.
It's a remarkable thing. So how, I mean, you've been off, how long ago was Ex Machina done? It's probably been...
Summer of, not 2014, 2013, 13? I guess.
So it's been around?
Would that be right?
Would it be?
I think it
last
is, right?
Last summer or the summer before?
Summer before, yeah. Yeah, so a while ago.
So you're going back to your juices for to have this conversation.
That's disgusting. No. Please don't return me to my own juices. It's awful.
Well, is it weird to go back after all that time and have people so enthusiastic about the movie and all of that?
But first of all, it's really good that it's people like it. That's like a relief. I know it's a relief to like Alex and stuff, but we were talking on the phone last night and I said, you know, we can't let that affect how we think of the film. I still look at the film and I still see the weaknesses of, you know, of my own, you know what I mean? Like, I still see all those things I wish I'd done differently. Mm. And it's important to hold on to those and not change those just because other people like the movie, right? Mm. And I did a movie with Alex called Never Let Me Go. I had like one scene in the film, but like I was hugely proud of that, but it didn't lift off and it was a pity, but it didn't change how I felt about the thing itself. It's gratifying that people are seeing it and liking it. It's difficult to argue with that. It's difficult to begrudging, you know, be saying, well, I don't care. You do care on some level, but you shouldn't try and let it change how you feel about it. Once this is done and once this round of press is done, then you leave it behind, right?
Yeah, I'm still bitter about Never Let Me Go.
How do you mean?
It's one of my, it's for me, that was actually my best movie that year. When
really?
It happened. It was one of my favorite movies in a long time, and I'm still suffering for it not having done better.
I know, and those performances were so beautiful, and I think that's a superb film. That's a film where, like, I'm really proud of the fact that I've got, like, you know, it's only one scene, but it's with four great actors, because Andrea Riseborough was in that scene, and like four great actors opposite me at the table, and I gotta do a scene with them, and I think it works in the film, and I think the film is gorgeous, and the fact that it didn't do great at the box office doesn't change at all how I feel about it, you know.
So what's the thing you like least about your performance in this? That's a terrible question. I feel compelled to ask.
I just watch myself. I just get frustrated that I'm not... See, Caleb doesn't do... I mean, you know, Caleb does stuff, but it's all hidden, right? Caleb does stuff. So I just watch myself and I get frustrated at myself for not punching Oscar in the face. You know what I mean? Earlier.
Huh.
Or for not releasing Alicia and saying, let's run and start a new life in the woods together or whatever. Like, I just get frustrated with him for that, but that's part of what the movie is.
So you're frustrated by the movie, it's what the limitations your character were in the movie, not your performance.
No, but the performance, maybe I could have done something with my performance to alleviate that, to feel stronger earlier, but he has to be weak. So, like, I'm arguing in my head between the possibilities of what I could have done to make him feel less powerless. And yet the reality is that he's supposed to be powerless in the movie. So it's difficult placing it in my head. But so all I know is I get frustrated, and dividing the frustration into performance and character are two different things, right?
And were you having that fight before you shot each of those sequences?
Was having those arguments in my head a little bit, yeah, I was. But like, what I take away from the film is that Alex is happy with what I did. And that's like, Alex is a hero of mine. Like, he really is. Mm. So that makes me happy. If I take enough steps back and forget about how I feel about when I see the movie, because people always, it's like hearing your own voice and going, I don't say, I'm that nasal, really? That's me? If Alex is happy, then I'm happy.
And in the context of this movie, I'm guessing you did not have a lot of conversation with the other two actors, other two major top actors, about what their subtext was or what was going on.
No, not a huge amount. No, it wouldn't have been. Yeah, you're better off battering each other with that during the scenes, right? Yeah. Which was, there was a lot of fun to be had there.
Well, they're all on different tips. I mean, they're all kind of on their own.
And what was nice as well is there was often a physical divide, particularly with Ava, but even with Oscar, there was often a physical divide too. You know, he'd be off exercising in between takes or doing push-ups or whatever, and I'd be listening to music and, you know, feeling very, very pressurized, and Alex would talk to, like, it wasn't a conversation with all three of us, but how the scene was going, Alex would talk to each of us individually, and then we'd go in with new ideas and bounce those off each other and see how that went. So it was a good way of doing it, you know. It's good.
And do you feel when you're shooting it that it's the other two actors, as you're watching them work in a scene, that it's happening, that you can feel that?
Yeah, I knew what Oscar was doing was great when he was doing it, and I knew what Alicia was doing was great when she was doing it. And part of your job then is, when the camera's pointing at them, is to help them develop that by offering up new possibilities and helping them get to other places in the scene. So I think a nice thing is when you see a film and you've been involved with other people's performances, is that some of the credit, if it works out well, not the credit, because the credit is all theirs, but in your head you can feel satisfied if both people are doing a good job, much more than if one person's doing a good job. You know, you can feel like, wow, we really came together and both got the best out of both of those performances for each other and for ourselves. So I thought that was satisfying when I watched Ex Machina.
It's a weird thing, because people, I don't think, realize that how critical a scene partner is in those moments.
Yeah, you put somebody else off camera.
Yeah.
And it'd be a very different thing, you know?
I don't think people would realize, like, you're watching the movie, it's been edited together, you kind of assume they're in the scene together, you don't realize there's two separate shots.
Yeah.
And at the same time, you don't realize how important it is that somebody was there servicing the close-up on the other side of it. It's a funny thing about movies.
And it's interesting, because some actors can just do that. They just need a tennis ball, and they can do the whole scene brilliantly or whatever. But I think with those big, long, 7-page scenes, if you really want to develop all the way through, I think throwing curveballs is important from off camera is important, and it was nice to be able to do that. That's probably all very boring, but it's a really important part of acting, actually, I think.
So was there anything that surprised you when you saw it all put together?
Yeah, there was lots of stuff that surprised me, including that there was a couple of scenes moved out of sequence. Mm. When I read the script, I thought there was a couple of things you could cut, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
But there's nothing you can move out of sequence. It's too... So when I saw it, I was really upset by it, weirdly. And I was like, why do I feel this way? Why doesn't this feel right? Because everybody else around me was saying, oh my God, that just... And I was like, no, there's something wrong here. And it was that he'd shifted a couple of the scenes around, and it works perfectly for the film because nobody else notices. But in my head, I'd live with that script for 6 months. And so, you know, I was like, totally, this totally just feels wrong. There's something wrong about this. And so that really surprised me, and how much it kind of upset my balance, the balance of the movie in my head, but was for the good of the film. Absolutely. Like, that's what Alex does great, is that he doesn't go in and try and make the movie in the edit exactly the same as the script. He goes in and takes all those raw materials and of the shoot, and then makes that into the best possible version of what it can be, not always trying to get back to exactly the script, you know. So that was interesting.
And how many times have you seen the movie? Just
I saw it once without effects and music early on, had a minor breakdown, and then and then I saw it at South By with Oscar sitting right in front of me, which was really funny. I actually reached forward about 2/3 of the way through the film. I reached forward and I think almost honestly tried to strangle him. I was watching myself just be abused by him on screen. I was just like, you fucking... I went and half joking and half wanting to strangle him.
Will you watch it again? Will you ever see it again?
I don't know. Maybe in a while. It would be interesting because, like, South By is a big, responsive audience who are out for a good time and may have been drinking since 12, you know. So it would be good to watch it. Good to watch it with in a more normalized environment.
Well, it feels like the kind of movie you can watch 5 or 6 times and get something out as an audience.
It's
harder when you were doing it, when you're in it.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. I think that's true. I think it probably might be a little bit difficult to do that, but. No, yeah, I'm sure I'll see it again at some point in the future. I'm just not quite ready for that yet.
And people are getting this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Movie like Anna Karenina, I think a lot of their negative response to it was that they just didn't like the idea of what he was trying to do with that.
Right.
Does that even faze you when they go, yeah, don't buy the premise? They're already out.
Yeah, it phases you. Yes, that's very true. I always try and go into a movie with an open mind, but I don't. I form my own opinions, so why should I expect people to react any differently to just because I'm in it? You know, like, really? But I'm in it. Why, don't you, aren't we friends? No, we're not, you know? So I have my own opinions about everything before I go in and see it. You can't help it, especially now when everything is... Like, if you'd walked into Anna Karenina and not known it was set in a theater and it just started that way, maybe you would have had your mind blown in a totally different way. Said, oh my God, they're going to stay in here. And then all the single shot stuff might have been amazing in a different way than how people reacted to it. I'm very proud of Anna Karenina. I like Anna Karenina a lot. But you can't have a problem with that. But it can be slightly like, I wish... I want other people to like the same stuff that I like, you know? And I don't like some of the stuff I've been in. But I do like some of the stuff I've been in, and it turns out other people haven't liked that, you know, like Never Let Me Go or whatever. There's enough people like it, but there's also plenty of people who don't.
Yeah.
And that makes you kind of like, oh, well, then what am I trying to do here? And I guess you just try and find like-minded individuals.
It's
like
a dating site. What you're trying to do.
Yeah. You know? Right.
No, it's funny.
That becomes problematic if enough people don't like it, though, right? That becomes a problem.
So nowadays, people go in to almost everything with so much preconceived ideas of what everything should be.
Right.
That, you know, it's having this conversation about Mad Men, which is, you know, on its second week of the last season right now.
Right.
And, you know, people are like, oh, so boring. You know, like, nothing's happening. I'm like, but that's, you know, just because you had this idea of what the, you know, big finale was going to be.
Right.
Doesn't mean they had to make that. They made what they made.
Yeah.
And if you
don't like it, then watch something else, I guess, right?
Yeah.
You know, they're not responsible for anything, really, you know?
Or just be open to what they're actually saying as opposed to what you thought they were going to say.
Right.
For the work.
Right, because then you're just watching it and you're waiting for them to color it in in the colors you expect, right? And that's not a way to watch something. It's interesting, though. That's why I don't watch long-form television. I don't really watch long series or whatever, because maybe it's because I start doing that. I like a 2-hour package that I can talk about afterwards and a single statement. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I find it difficult to do the long, even though everybody tells me that's where the best drama is now.
Well, I think it's one of the things that people love about Ex Machina is that they don't know, they didn't know it was coming completely, and they get to own the experience themselves.
And you can talk about it immediately afterwards too, you know what I mean? Like when we were doing the press earlier on, I kind of mentioned it a couple of times, but it's true, I think, the fact that the twists and turns in this are not there just because you need a twist on page 30 and then you need another one, you know what I mean? Like, they're not there to fulfill those. They work very well, but they all feel totally organic and natural in the film to me. They feel like a story. They don't feel like a twist and turn on the way to an inevitable conclusion or another crap turn at the end or whatever, you know what I mean? That's part of what I like about it. And when you have a series that's that long, like 24 was great, but me and my buddies all got together and watched it in 24 hours. Like, we've started, like, you know, when I say me and my buddies, I mean my three sad friends. It started at 6 in the morning, you know, like the clock, so we all met at 6 in the morning. And then we'd watch, because they're 40 minutes long. Uh-huh. So you'd watch 40 minutes, and then on the 20-minute break, you had to, we set each other missions to do. So you'd have to get the shopping by croissants, or you'd have to set up a TV in the back garden and start watching the next episode in the back garden, but always by the time, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So we did that, but when you watch 24 in 24 hours, as I did, there are so, but halfway through you're like, what? You know what I mean? There are so many different things it has to do to keep that interesting for 24 hours, you know, on a certain level. There's a reason they show it once a week, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, although on Netflix now, I guess you watch everything.
Well, the genius of British television, which is where I feel like all this came from. Like, I mean, the whole grouping, you know, having these shows where people binge watch.
Yeah.
And it's 13, and that's, you know, the genius of the British version of it, which has been around for a long time, is that it stopped. You know,
yeah.
You didn't get episode season 23 of Cracker.
No,
you know,
he
did four or five seasons and it was
over. And The Office, you have two seasons and a Christmas special that actually, and I love The American Office, but there's something so beautiful about that just being finite.
Yeah.
You know? So I can handle that. I can't do the other thing. I can't do the open-ended crap. People like it enough that we have to do an eighth series sort of thing, you know. I don't like that so much.
No, it's shocking how little Monty Python there is, or how little Towers there
how
is.
How quickly you can watch all of them.
Yeah.
I used to watch that stuff with my, like, my grandparents loved Fawlty Towers, my granddad in particular. Used to watch it with him, and I was like, oh my God, we're done. Crazy. Yeah. We're done. We've watched all of them.
But you'd watch him again.
Especially because his memory was awful, so we could just play it again immediately. He had no idea. It was
my father watched MASH that way when he got older. He just, like, he didn't remember watching it the first time around.
Yeah,
like,
perfect.
A new series.
Oh my God, he's we knew that. We watched it yesterday. Yeah, yeah.
He died? Yeah.
Oh, what the hell? Yeah.
It's shocking. Well, I'll wait for the different ending on Ex Machina next time I see it.
Yeah, you never know.
A whole different movie. Know.
Yeah. I'm trying to think. No, there was never anything super different at the end. There was a couple of little nuances which were different. Originally, he had it at the end that when she talked to the pilot of the thing, mm-hmm. he's a great actor, Corey, she talks to the pilot of the helicopter, and for a second, you see him as she sees him. Hmm. So you see static, and you see numbers, and, you know, mm-hmm. it's a digital output that she's taking in. And then when he opens his mouth, you hear just, you know, the way, and for a second you get to see the world the way that she does. But actually, I think possibly because Alicia is so fantastic in it, at that point you're on side with her. I think you're happy she's got, some people are happy she's got out, some people are annoyed about how she left Caleb, me included.
Sequel.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I think he's fine. So they didn't need that. So that was one of the things that was cut from the end.
But when she puts on her skin, it's kind of like a coming of age moment. So it's.
It is.
It's almost like you don't want to ruin it by breaking the.
By telling us that she's not a real girl. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. I think that's true. You don't want to break that illusion.
Yeah. So I heard for funding they were going to have her put on Jennifer Lawrence's skin for.
Didn't work out. No, and it was Mystique the whole way through.
Mystique.
Yeah. Clever girl.
Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you very much. Yeah, thanks.
Thanks.
Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you.